So, hi, my name is David, but I'm not the main event. These two guys are. So if you can perhaps introduce yourself and what do you actually do in your companies?
Okay, my name's David Gilmore. So those of you who turned up to expect to hear some music, you better ask for your money back. Okay, I'll get that one out of the way. It comes up often in Israel. I lead the BP Ventures team, which is the global venture arm of BP. And we have teams based around all the major tech centers in the world. That's in the Valley. We're in New York. We've got staff in China, India. And we're growing our presence in these tech centers. And why are we doing that? It's because we're starting as a world to go through the energy transition. And the energy transition at the current stage is relatively straightforward. We have oil and gas, and we generate all the energy we need. But BP's core purpose is to provide energy in a sustainable way. And we know life's going to get much more complicated as we go through. So we're in a major disruption. And the role of the BP Ventures team is to cast a searchlight, is to actually identify those technology developments, those companies are going to be offering a path forward for us to actually look at the way of delivering energy in a sustainable way. So with that in mind, we have a full broad range of activities we engage in. It's into bio products. We're looking at carbon capture and management. We're looking at the impact of digital, and we just heard some stuff around ride sharing. But one of the key areas is the area we call advanced mobility, and that is in the electrification of transportation. And that becomes absolutely critical for BP if we start thinking about how we do we deliver mobility in a sustainable way through the energy transition. And it's in that reason that we form both an investing relationship with Stordot, but also a strategic collaboration with Stordot. So pass through to Erez to actually talk about Stordot.
All right. Thanks. So I'm Erez Lorber. I'm the COO of Stordot. Stordot was founded in 2012 and raised $130 million to develop ultra-fast charging battery cells. That means using nanotechnology, breakthrough chemistry. We have assembled 120 employees, an amazing team, of which 30 of them are PhDs in electrochemistry, organic chemistry. We have 40 master's degrees, so really great team of people assembled and established great lines, you know, labs, pilot lines, etc. And we believe that mobility and global adoption of electric vehicles will only come when you have fast charge capabilities, because most of the world cannot slow charge. Most of the world do not own a private house, a private garage, and they have to rely on public charging infrastructure. And this is why we're focused mainly on fast charging batteries, and this is why the relationship with BP is so critical for us, because they come as a part of the ecosystem where they bring all the charging infrastructure, we bring the enabling technology to charge fast. But apart from BP, we also have Daimler and Samsung and TDK, many great strategic partners.
Cool. So we have 11 and a half minutes, and I'll be very Israeli and tachless. The real question, because this is a great partnership between a corporate and a startup, is why the hell should anybody care about this? I mean, it sounds cool and it's a great amount of money, but why does it matter?
So let me tell you a story. I was in Oslo last week, and I went there particularly to see what's happening in the market with respect to electric vehicles. And in Oslo, the car sales this year are something like 55% are battery electric vehicles.
And so that's 50% of all the cars
over 55.
Over 50%.
And that's because the Norwegian government's offered a really good subsidy to the citizens of Norway to go electric. And therefore, you can actually start seeing now what happens in a city like Oslo when you've got something like 10, 15% of the car park now is electric. Oslo citizens go off at the weekend to their cabin in the north, I'm told. And in terms of dealing with that issue, after 2 hours driving, you can actually charge your car up in half an hour, have your coffee, and move into the north of Norway and enjoy your vacation. So a 20, 30 minute charge isn't an issue. There's a new anxiety. That issue of range anxiety has largely been solved by the battery industry. But there's a new issue, which is now the absence of infrastructure in Oslo means that when you start looking now at something else now called, which is queue anxiety, and I was told stories that where we now have high density of electric vehicles, where the infrastructure is not keeping up with the demand of electric vehicles, there are now situations where there's been fighting involved between drivers who are waiting to get their vehicle charged. So let's just imagine that now, which is that you've got more cars going into two or three charge points situated in the city, somebody queue jumps and you're waiting for 30 minutes more, because the average charge time, was told by one of the charge point operators, was 27 minutes. We have to offer for electric vehicles to become the norm and therefore start decarbonising the mobility industry. It's absolutely essential that we offer at least the same convenience as you get from hydrocarbons. That means 5 minutes. It means you need to have a technology that means that you can turn up to a retail station and actually be able to charge your car up and be good to go. Fortunately also, most people have a garage and they actually have a place at home to charge their cars. So at this stage, in a very, very wealthy population, 80% of the charges are occurring at home. But as electric vehicles get mandated by governments to become the norm, then large numbers of people who are living in flats will not have access to charging in the garage, and therefore the importance of building infrastructure at flat level, apartment level, car park level, and to be able to do that efficiently starts becoming a critical enabler of the decarbonisation of the mobility system. And that is really important to BP, important because it fulfils our purpose about decarbonising the energy system, and importantly, it maintains the relevance of our retail assets, offering the same level of convenience in the current world as it would do in the electric world.
Startup world, what we basically say is there's a meme out there that says in the Maslow pyramid of needs, there's food and security. Under it, there's Wi-Fi. But under Wi-Fi, as basic need, there's power. And if I understand you correctly, what you're saying is if there's no power, you won't get to mass adoption of EV.
That's my belief. That needs to occur for mass adoption, that we need wide-ranging infrastructure. It's not all copper wire and technology. There's okay. Got a huge digital activity around load balancing, around really understanding how to ration out power around the system, whether it's your fridge, freezer, home, lights, EV, all of that's getting mixed up.
Errors is kind of almost
jumping. I just wanted to comment on what David just mentioned. It's not just passenger cars. I mean, we look at the passenger cars example and we say, no, we don't want to get into range anxiety with battery-operated electric vehicles.
Yeah.
But if you think about the future, and we know that the mobility revolution is going on, I mean, electrification is going on, shared, connected, autonomous later on. If you look now on Uber, just the previous presentation, Didi, Lyft, and other sort of shared, you know, carpool, whatever services, you need the utilization when you move them into electric vehicles. And you can get utilization only if you charge really fast, because you don't want the cars to be idle for too long. You want them to go from one customer to the other, so the downtime is minimized. And this is another reason why you have to go into very fast charging.
So in the industry, I think Tesla just announced a couple of days that they came with a breakthrough of new batteries. But they always talk about the range aspect of it. It's always about 120 miles, then 500 miles, and so on and so forth. So where is the inflection point? Because speed is probably important, but it's probably more for the micro-mobility at this point. Why? Because even your own video talked about scooters.
Right. So we started with a scooter just as a proof of concept, which was a joint collaboration and in the partnership with BP. We did it together. But it was really more of a proof of concept, not to say that there's no potential in scooters and micro-mobility. But when you look at electric vehicles, it's going to be a huge, enormous market for us. And we focused all along on fast charging, meaning range is very important. And if you go into technical terms, then range means energy density, the ability to absorb a lot of energy in a battery when you charge it, okay? So when everybody else was focused on range, getting to the 500, 600 kilometers range, we said that even if you charge it a bit less, let's say even if you get 350 kilometers, but you can achieve it in 5 minute charging, that's really the critical factor for mass adoption. Because I'm sure that when you bought your last car, whatever you're driving, you didn't look at how much range you can get per fueling, right? I mean, people don't actually look.
Hybrid, so it's okay.
A hybrid, okay, so you're on the right track. So it's really fast charging is really more of a critical element for mass adoption than range alone. Doesn't mean that we need to compromise too much on range, but it's not really the leading factor, and this is why our focus is different than other batteries.
I do actually see this. So actually, what we're seeing at the moment is that it's the early adopters who are actually driving electric vehicles, and they're willing to put up the inconvenience of charging and range. If we really want to move to mass market, which is a scaling, we have to cross the chasm. Crossing the chasm means dealing with the with the pain point of queue anxiety. And the technology solution to that is ultra-fast charging, which is why BP has made this investment in StoreDot, is to help StoreDot succeed and thrive and draw in other technologies and capabilities that will allow ultra-fast charging to occur to allow the scale-up of battery electric vehicle across the industry.
So if I'm thinking about, when we talk micro-mobility scooters and everything that's booming like crazy now versus the long-term cars, buses, trucks, and likes, is it actually the same infrastructure? Because, I mean, when I look into the future, my horrid vision is 500 cables charging scooters and then 5,000 cables charging cars. How does that combine? What's the is the underlying infrastructure that charges everybody?
Well, there needs to be a convergence of standard so that actually
which
you don't...
there isn't.
Right. It's moving forward. There is some standardization occurring. I think that will actually work its way through, particularly in places like Europe. There's a conversion. China's probably the fastest growing market, so the question will be, which is the global standard? Is it going to be Chinese driven or European driven? They're the two markets. And that's very, very interesting one for the way the actual industry, is, particularly the battery industry, develops. Is the future Chinese or is it something which is more global? So all of that's, I think, going to get played out. I think we're going to see a mixture of different fast charging technologies. You can imagine for 2- and 3-wheel scooters in India, you can imagine a charging network based around battery swapping, where the batteries are swapped and charging occurs maybe in a service station. For passenger vehicles, describing an infrastructure which is mixed between home, car park, supermarkets, retail stations.
Yeah.
And for the larger vehicles, it could be, I think it's not clear yet, but there's going to be a competition between fuel cell technology around hydrogen and electric. So it could well be, as we go forward, we're going to see a mixed mode depending on the particular use case. So this is why we're venturing. It's because we don't understand there is an answer to the issue of how we actually ensure convenience and ultra-fast charging. There are different technologies. Battery electric vehicle is scalable, and it's actually moving rapidly in the automotive industry, particularly for passenger car. I think we're going to see this mix around the edges for the scooters and also for the heavy vehicles, hydrogen and maybe battery swapping, acting together with ultra-fast
charging. There's going to be a convergence in the market.
I think there's a convergence of standard. I think there will probably be different energy forms depending on the use case of the vehicle involved.
Okay. So now, Erez, David isn't really here, okay? Just you and me. They invested, can I say how much they invested? Is it public now?
Ask him, don't ask me.
They invested.
We've invested 20 million in StoreDot.
20 million in StoreDot.
Yeah,
right.
So no offense, you're a huge corporate.
Yeah.
They're 120 people team. Are they good? Other than the money, which is always
first
good.
First of all, they're the best because David is here.
Yeah.
Okay.
But other than that, I think that it's actually a really good example of how the relationship could work between, let's say, an Israeli startup, which we are one, and a huge corporation. Once you have your stories aligned, I mean, we count on them as being a part of the ecosystem that will enable power that we need to charge our batteries very fast. So we at the beginning we had some, you know, some doubts, and we said, okay, now let's focus and let's put a team together to see how we can work together. Will we get their attention or not? But very quickly we saw that they're really engaged. I mean, we're constantly in the UK and they're in Israel.
So
we
their work team together comes to Israel.
Their team is coming, their teams are coming to Israel, actually teams. So we have very, very close relationship. They're working on standards, regulations, charging infrastructure. We're working on an enabling technology for fast charging. And we're really even thinking about creative things that we can do together so we're not stuck. I mean, this demo was one of the projects that actually came as an idea from the BP team, and we executed on that. We're going to have another demo, a real live demo, of charging a scooter in five minutes in London on November, I guess November 23rd or something. So we are actually really working closely together, and this is a great thing because they're also not in any conflict with any other strategic partner that we have. So Daimler is bringing a car, TDK is bringing the mass production capabilities of...
So you build a coalition of...
So we have a ecosystem, which is great.
I think somebody wants us to finish for some reason.
All right.
So on that note, I want to thank my guests for today. A show of hands will be great.